lesson this morning is taken from Psalm 126. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream, that our mouth was filled with laughter and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the water courses in the Negev. May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy. Those who go out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, carrying their sheaves. Our second lesson is from Isaiah 61, verses 10 through 11. I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My whole being shall exult in my God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decks himself with a garland, and as a bride adorns herself with jewels. For as the earth brings forth its shoots, and as a garden causes what is sown in it to spring up, so the Lord God will cause righteousness and praise to spring up before all the nations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God indeed. You know, we read through these Hebrew Bible passages all throughout this season of Advent, waiting upon the coming of the newborn Prince of Peace, and even those words come out of the prophets. And the prophets are writing during a period far earlier in history than the one immediately preceding Jesus' coming or birth in the earth. But it seems like every season of our lives we're waiting for a hero to be born. And likewise, the Hebrew people were waiting for a Messiah to be born. You know, I think we get so removed from the real meaning of Christmas, so stressed out, right, and so overwhelmed and so much in a hurry and maybe worried about the wrong things that we find ourselves in the parking lot of the mall and thanking God for a parking space, right? That, I do it. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I have to drive around 16 times and then decide to leave because I'm so irritated by all of this consumerism that I'm there eager to participate in. But it's true. We get really removed from the real meaning of Christmas, and we sometimes will thank God for those small things. I think the danger is really, though, that we're actually thinking that God has a point of view. It's sort of like when I see on Facebook that, you know, please Jesus, may the Giants win, and that's not a thing happening, I don't think. And so I wonder, what is it that we're asking God for? What is it that we want? And if we're honest about these things, we realize that oftentimes we've got pretty high class problems, right? Nothing to wear with a closet filled with clothes, right? When you're young, I said this at 8:30 and all the swicky kids were like, oh my gosh, like, you know, a pimple, right? Before the dance, oh my gosh, right? It's a big deal. Because when we're young, when we are, they talk about moments are magnified and the 60-second silence feels like 3 hours, right? But we change and we grow up and we're supposed to chill a little. And then we get a lot older and your body doesn't really have much of a choice but chill, you know? But that's a gift. And it's the attitude and the spirit that we possess that we want to grow and mature and have perspective. So that if we want to be upset about our high-class problems, we at least keep them in some perspective. And so it's true that we read through these passages of the Hebrew Bible, and I want to set them in context to give us a sense of the promise of God. So my prayer is that you'll be able to sort of think about the Hebrew people, all they had been through, and think about, wow, if this is real, what God wants for us. And so it's true that throughout the period of the history of the Hebrew Bible, you might remember that people of the judges, right, and the tribes decided they needed a king. They needed a king, just like the other nations needed a king. And there was a divided kingdom, right? And then there was a united kingdom. And this is around the year 1000. And then about 3 years later, about 722, they're already dealing with the Empire of Assyria, taking them into captivity and removing them from everything that they knew. Again, not but 2 years later, 586, right, the Babylonian Empire is going to take them into exile again. So imagine us. You know, we talk about our country. We're fairly new as a people, right? Imagine that all of a sudden somebody was going to take us over and send us back where we came from. Imagine that we were then removed from this place we knew and loved, our churches, our families, our homes, our vineyards, our shopping center, our bank, removed from everything that we knew. 200 years of people controlling us. 200 years of living in a strange land, being forced in many ways to sort of commingle and hang in their cultures, tempted to worship their gods, right? And somehow the Hebrew people got through this period with the promise of the prophets. Here's just another way to look at it on a timeline. The Assyrian period, the Babylonian period, and you're like, why do we care about this? Mainly, so we have a sense of what was really happening when the people heard Isaiah say, I will not forget you. I've got your name engraved on my hand. When you're dealing with a broken relationship or a broken family, when your kids are not talking to you, or worse yet, you can't find them. When your relationship is broken and you're dealing with divorce, or someone's been diagnosed and you're feeling exiled because there's no one to care for your aging parent. Or someone's lonely or going to jail. Your kid going to jail. When we have these moments of exile in our own lives, we can hear God say, I will not forget you. I didn't bring you this far. The overriding theme of the Bible that we're talking about here, what I love about disciple Bible study, you know, Cokesbury, the United Methodist Publishing Company, puts out this very intensive number of courses called Disciple. But the Disciple One, week by week by week, focuses on what they would call a theme of the Bible. A theme of the Bible, and the theme for this morning is restoration. That somehow, when we lose something, or something gets broken, or something's been taken from us, that maybe not it, the thing, but something will be restored. We, or the collective we, certainly for the Hebrew people, it's a collective we, and we're trying to apply these texts to our own lives, we'll know restoration. We might know healing. We might know some sort of recovery. You know, people who practice a 12-step program for alcohol or drugs or gambling or food, whatever it is, the second step after first admitting that they don't have a lot of control over this thing that's controlling them, step two says, came to believe because something's gone a little insane. Something is not able to be kept in check. Something in our lives is calling us away time and time and time again. We're not making good choices. I will not forget you, God said. I have engraved you on the palm of my hand. I don't know if you need to hear that this morning. I don't know what form of exile you're feeling, how you're feeling removed or broken, how it is that restoration would look for you. But as Christian people, God is calling us to leave our captivity, leave whatever it is that's been broken behind. Work toward healing, work toward repairing, work toward restoration. Find a spiritual friend, be on the journey with them, talk to your pastor, get the help that we need, so that we too, not unlike the Hebrew people, who are in captivity and hear God's voice saying, come home. Come home to your homeland, your family, your loved ones. Come home to some sense of God's protection in your lives. Because in this season of Advent and Christmas, we are all being called home to see that light in the sky and to follow that light. And to hear God say, like the people heard God say, I will restore your ruin. I will restore Puerto Rico. For those people who are literally understanding what it means to walk in darkness and perceive the great light that is Jesus. We're all in a relative darkness. Some of our souls are dim. Some of our worry about the world is real. Some of us are just feeling like we might need to get grateful. You know, those high-class problems are really a sign of blessing. And so we bring ourselves home to adjust our attitudes and spirits. The passage from the Psalms is actually a song that is in response to this period. He's going to turn mourning into dancing. God's going to turn a faint spirit into praise and gratitude. God is going to restore whatever it is that's been ruined. But we need to ask. We need to tell God what we need. We need to be clear and true and real. That on this journey through the weeks of Advent, when God's hope and God's love and God's joy and God's light is so real, that we make that a part of who we are, that we carry out into the world, so that the people who walk in darkness might see a great light. Puerto Rico, families in California, families all over the world who are being told no thank you, will find their way home and follow the light, especially